Está para baixo da linha do incêndio.
Por que não vamos até lá?
With any implosion, you don't hear one massive boom sound. What you do hear is smaller explosions going off. Mr. Sunder of NIST has said that you would, if this had been a controlled demolition, you would have heard a large, massive bomb going off.
The World Trade Center. You can see the firemen assembled here, the police officers, FBI agents.
What in reality happens with a controlled demolition is you hear a successive, progressive, smaller waves of smaller explosions going off. In the case of thermite cutting charges, you would have heard far less noise since they are worked by thermal heating, melting of the steel, rather than an explosive cutting as in RDX charges. I knew from day one that this was a controlled event. And why I did that is because simply looking at Building 7, you have a sudden collapse of the building. It's fairly symmetrical as it comes down. There's the classic kink, which means that the center core fails first, and you can see that on the video, and the building falls near free fall. So I really honestly didn't believe this from day one, because this is the way buildings classically come down with a controlled demolition.
This material is not normal thermite. That's the other thing that really needs to be understood. Anybody could make normal thermite. You can get the ingredients, you can mix them together, you can make them. Any kid could basically do it if they knew the recipe. This material is composed of the real key ingredient that I don't think anybody else could really make in a convenient way is the nano aluminum. It's a controlled substance. I could go buy it, but the government limits how much I can buy of it. It's very, very difficult to produce in these sizes and to keep from reacting. It's not something that you just get at the local five and dime or you're going to make on your own. It's a very, very difficult to make material. And that's the one thing in there that really tells me specifically that this wasn't some guys working in caves in Afghanistan, or it wasn't you know, somebody in their basement doing this. This was, you know, a massive engineering operation that made these materials. So the military uses it for a number of different applications. Another one, if you do a search on Google for thermite and building demolition, you can find all sorts of wonderful devices that have been fabricated and invented that use thermite for building demolitions. An example would be that in 1984 there was a patent issued for thermite cutter charges to be used in building demolitions that could shoot molten iron through the structural steel in milliseconds.
In die Fahrstuhlschächte hinunter. Der Rest verbrennt schnell, verbrennt schnell und Schächte hinunter. Der Rest verbrennt schnell und schnell.
I wondered how NIST could play dumb so well. How could they not think about nanothermite at all? Because they seem to have a lot of very well-qualified people who should have thought of that right away. And some of the people involved, for example, are the directors of NIST at the time. In October of 2001, Bush nominated a guy named Arden Beamont, who was a materials science engineer. I mean, he's the kind of guy that would know high-tech materials better than anybody. He had just come from Purdue University. Purdue had a thriving nanothermite program under a professor by the name of Stephen Sun, who came from Los Alamos National Laboratories. So Bement really should have known. He had several other interesting connections, but then he was replaced by a guy named Harach Semerjian. And Semerjian not only had the background, but he wrote 10 papers with the world's leading expert on nanothermites, a guy named Michael Zacharia. Michael Zacharia has written more on nanothermites than anyone, I think. And he worked at the University of Minnesota for a while. Prior to that, he worked at NIST as well. So Michael Zacharia worked at NIST, but yet NIST can't figure out the possibilities of nanothermite. You know, whenever thermite was brought up to them over the years, they'd always say, oh, "Gee, that wouldn't make any sense. We'd have to have 1,000,000 pounds of thermite," which obviously is not true. If anybody's seen the new video by my friend John Cole, who's also a board member at Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth, he's got a video called "The Great Thermite Debate." You can find it on 9/11 Blogger, and he shows that all these people who said you need all these gazillion pounds of thermite are crazy, and that, you know, people who said thermite can't cut steel columns are crazy, because, you know, he did it in his backyard. So obviously it can be done, and it can be done very efficiently. But Harach Semerjian wrote this paper, then these 10 papers with this world's leading expert on nanothermite. Then we go into the company that provided the largest contingent of non-government employees. This is a really interesting company. It's called Science Applications International Corporation, or SAIC. And SAIC, as I said, provided all these people to the NIST investigation. They're all listed. This huge group of people are listed in the report as being authors of the report, essentially. But SAIC has this long history at the World Trade Center. In 1986, they did an evaluation of threats to the World Trade Center, and they proposed that a big bomb in the basement, just exactly like the one that happened 7 years later, 1993, would do a lot of damage, right? So they provided this scenario, and in 1993, when it did happen, it was SAIC that provided the official explanation for what happened. And then in 2001, they're hired after 2001 to help NIST write this report on what happened on 9/11. But SAIC, they make nanothermites. They're a huge corporation, but they have a subsidiary called Applied Ordnance Technology that not only makes nanothermites, they specialize in laser ignition of nanothermites.
Kerosin die Fahrstuhlschächte hinunter. Der Rest verbrennt schnell. Innen verbrennt schnell und Schächte hinunter. Der Rest verbrennt schnell und schnell.
And they also are involved in projects where they like dole out money for research on nanothermite. So, but SAIC is just really interesting because it's this intelligence contractor. That's what they're known for the most part. They even spy on the CIA. The CIA hires SAIC to spy on their employees. That, you know, it's a little bit crazy. SAIC provided evidence to kind of prove that Iraq needed to be invaded. The evidence against Saddam. They provided the evidence. They provided the evidence, the intelligence evidence for the capture of Khalid Sheikh Mohammed. They trained the Saudi Navy. They have employees like Robert Gates, who's our current defense secretary. They did. Jerome Hauer, who was the OEM director at the World Trade Center. John Deutsch was a CIA director, and so on and so on.
So they're
basically the CIA. That's who they are.
And they're in there as the biggest outside component in NIST, while NIST is doing its reports on the towers and on
right.
WTC-7 as well?
That's right. Yeah, and so, you know, it's crazy that they could be so connected to the history of the World Trade Center and everything that happened to it, and all the evidence for what's happened over the last 10 years, and have all these CIA directors working for them and so forth, and people just say, oh, that's all right, no problem at all. SAIC gave us the official explanation for what happened to the World Trade Center. Right there in New York City, involved in the events, were also involved in investigating BCCI. I mean, Michael Cherkasky, for example, was. He was at the time the chairman of Kroll at the time of 9/11, but he had been previously a assistant DA and investigated BCCI and a lot of other people. So that's what interests me about Giuliani. I get the impression from Giuliani's interview with Peter Jennings on the day of 9/11 that when he went ahead and said, you know, we were told the buildings were going to come down, you know, he admitted that he had foreknowledge in that sense. I get the impression
yes.
from him that he was not deeply involved and didn't have deep knowledge of the operation itself. He just was told, you know, get the heck out of the way and then shut up, you know, or then play along or whatever. That's the impression I get. But there is another guy very closely associated with Giuliani named Bernard Carrick, who was the New York City police commissioner on 9/11 and also considered a hero of the day. And Carrick, he just looks the part of a mobster. He was Giuliani's chauffeur in 1993. But in the 70s, he later was an employee of the Saudi royal family, as well as an employee of, again, Morrison Knudsen in Saudi Arabia. So, and he, you know, he's just this thug. He ended up later becoming a chauffeur for Giuliani, then the Department of Corrections officer, and then the police commissioner of New York City. His police department provided that passport that magically fell by the wayside at the South Tower and was picked up and provided evidence for who the culprits were. But, you know, we really ought to be serious, because Bernard Kerik is in jail right now. And, you know, he was accused of so many crimes, it's just ridiculous. And he was ultimately thrown away. He's in jail right now. And so this guy who was clearly a mobster, clearly tied to Saudi Arabia, you know, one of the most interesting things about Kerik is on the day of 9/11, and we're talking about very early, George Pataki, the governor, and Giuliani and Kerik show up on national television. And one of the first questions Giuliani gets from the press is, a lot of people are talking about secondary explosives. Were there explosions that helped bring down the World Trade Center buildings? And Giuliani looks around like stunned, you know, and he looks back to Kerik for the answer. I'm not kidding. And Bernard Kerik shakes his head, no, there were no explosives. So that's when we got the first official answer that there were no explosives used on 9/11 from Bernard Kerik, who is now in jail. And I think we ought to maybe take a second look at that official explanation.
I think maybe some people at NIST may end up in jail alongside Kerik, so they've continued to say that no explosives were used.
That's another thing I want to talk about. Giuliani is a high up knight of Malta. In 2001, him and Cardinal Egan, who is the Archbishop of New York, they are both Knights of Malta, okay? And they oversaw the biggest terror attack in American history and in the history of the world, probably. And in 2001, they were both given prestigious Knight of Malta awards, Giuliani and Egan, okay? And I have it at my website. Now, if you people would just start looking into what I'm telling you, you would find what I'm finding, okay? That they're Knights of Malta all involved in all this.
Here are the facts.